Hey, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Live Point Church. We're so glad that you're joining us today online from home or wherever you find yourself this morning. We hope you had a great Christmas. This morning, let's worship the Lord and let's allow Him to speak to our hearts. Amen.
Worthy of every song we can ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we can ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. And say, Jesus, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who can ever say. Worthy of every breath we can ever breathe, we live for you. What a moment you have brought me to, such a freedom I have found in you. You're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. You have risen with all power in your hands. You have given me a second chance. Hallelujah, hallelujah, yeah, 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 yeah. I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving. Find yourself, declare this and say, you make all things new. God, just lift your voice and sing and say, God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to time, say, God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to if he's been good to you, give him praise right where you are. Hallelujah.
Well, hey, everybody, and welcome to the last Sunday service of 2020. What a year it has been. And I just want to take a moment and say welcome to all of you, no matter where you're watching from, if you're in town, If you're anywhere else around the state or around the world, we are so honored to be one church in many places. And thank you for tuning in with your family today. I hope you enjoyed our time of worship. Pastor Elmer always does such a phenomenal job leading us into the presence of the Holy Spirit. Hey, thank you for joining us. If you're new with us, would love to connect with you. Simply drop a text. Text the letters LPC and the number is 31996. We're going to send you a quick text back with some simple next steps of how to connect with you and how you can get more connected with us. Hey, we're getting into 2021. By now, you've eaten all the Christmas food. You've probably got some sweets left over, and maybe your kids have broken all their presents, but at least that's the way I did it every year. 2 days into having new presents, they were all broken. But what I'm most excited about at this point of the year is looking forward to 2021. And honestly, this is always a season of expectation and excitement for me as I get ready for the new year, because we start every year with 21 days of fasting and prayer. 21 days of fasting and prayer is such a part of our church story. In fact, many people want to ask about what's happened to LifePoint, how did it grow so fast, or what are some of our tricks up our sleeve, which we don't have any tricks or secrets. But one of the things we have done consistently, as long as I've been pastor here, is we've started every year with 21 days of fasting and prayer. I'm asking everyone that's watching this sermon, everyone that's a part of our church, would you consider being a part of our 21-day fast? Fast something, whether it's one meal, one type of food, two types of food, or if you're going to do like me, fast total food fasts for 21 days. I really believe this is a key part of what sets us up to endure the year that's ahead of us. And 21 days of fasting and prayer is something that we've done for so long. And I want to invite all of you to participate with us in some way. And for the last 2 or 3 years, we have partnered our 21-day fast with Convoy of Hope to provide clean drinking water for people all around the world. In fact, LifePoint, we are getting to lead the way in an initiative to provide clean drinking water through churches and through times of fasting for churches all over the country. So thank you for leading the way. And what we basically asked is, whatever you fast over the next 3 weeks, just save the money that you would have spent on that thing. So if you give up coffees for the next 3 weeks, or you give up some kind of food, save what you would have spent on that. And by the end of 3 weeks, donate that through LifePoint Church to Convoy of Hope to provide clean drinking water. And the easiest way that I know how to show you that is $25 will provide a filter to filter 1 million gallons of water for a family. So if every person in our church would donate $25 by the end of this 21-day fast, just imagine the impact we can have providing clean drinking water for families around the world. So thank you for being a part of that. But regardless of the clean drinking water, regardless of what we do with that money, I'm inviting everyone to join us for 21 days of fasting and prayer, and let's get ourselves ready for everything that the Lord is going to allow to happen and what will come our way in 2021. That being the case, this is always a time of establishing New Year's resolutions. Does anybody else hate New Year's resolutions? I know that I do. And the reason I hate them is not because of the wishful thinking or the good intentions on the front end of the year. It's because I blow them by February, right? Like, I've started Bible reading plans at the beginning of the year, and by March or April, I'm behind. I've started fitness resolutions by the beginning of the year, and by February or March, I'm behind. Diet resolutions. All these resolutions are things that we resolve in our own strength to do, but very often, because our strength falters and fails, we end up getting behind pretty soon into the year. But what if we had a revolutionary year instead of a resolute year, right? And years ago, I preached a message on New Year's revolutions. A revolution is a revolt, right? It's kind of a violent revolt against the norm, against the status quo. What if we revolted with some things in our lives this year and moved forward in the things of God just in a revolutionary fashion? Like, we're going to commit to some times in prayer, times in the Word, serving other people, giving at a certain rate, or sharing our faith. We're going to revolt against patterns of sin and idolatry and unforgiveness that we've carried for so long. We're going to have some revolutionary decisions in 2021. So that's what I really want to challenge you on as we get ready for 2021, to establish some decisions that I'm going to revolt against some things in my past. I'm going to revolt against some things that I've carried with me, or some habits, practices, or patterns. And I'm going to step forward into 2021 with some decisions, some hard decisions, that this will be the best year I've ever had with the Lord, with His church, with His people, and for His kingdom. So that's what I want us to talk about for the remainder of our time together. And as we get into this message, I've got some notes for you on the bottom of the screen. And just write some notes down. I think there's some things here that'll really speak to you. The first is, I want us to deal with current realities. Like, where are we at currently? And really, you are the only one that can answer the question of how is your relationship with the Lord? How's it going between you and Jesus? What's your prayer life look like? What's your worship life look like? How does generosity impact the normal realities of your life? When's the last time you shared your faith? How are you doing treating your family and your friends, your loved ones? What's your heart towards those that you would consider enemies or those that you just don't agree with or are misaligned with? How are you doing? As I think about our church, and typically I have some stats to report to you every year, and we put our business meeting together by the end of January or beginning of February, and we've got stats, and all the numbers seem to be climbing every year, year over year. This past year is a little different. Attendance is way down because of a pandemic. Relationships have been strained due to social and cultural crises, and there's so many things that are warring against our affections for each other, our hearts for one another, and maybe even that has transitioned into the realities of our heart for God. So I want to ask you on the front end of this, what's the current reality of how you're doing with the Lord? What I love about God is he's always gracious to say, wherever you're at, you've got room to grow. He's never punitive. He doesn't want to punish you if you've blown it in 2020 or you've drifted from the Lord. His invitation is always there to say, well, come on back. I'm here. I'm ready. I love you. I forgive you. And let's move forward together. You know, as the church globally, we have some current realities that we think matter the most. Number one, we just have a commitment that the Bible is true. God's word is alive and active. 2 Timothy 3 says it's alive and active and that it's profitable for teaching and training us in righteousness, right? So that's a reality for us. We have a high view of scripture. A second one is we have a high view that Jesus is the only way to heaven. He died for our sin, and we put our faith and confidence in his sacrifice on the cross and resurrection. And that's the way that we find eternal life. Third, we believe you have to be born again. If you're going to meet the Lord, Jesus is the only way. If you're going to meet God, it has to be through Christ. You have to be born again, which is surrendering your old life, repenting from your sin, and surrendering to a life of devotion to the Lord Jesus. And then fourth, we believe absolutely that you can live a spirit-led life, full of devotion to Jesus, full of commitment to his word, committed to the body of Christ, as flawed as she may be. Come on now. We all know church has its issues, but we can still be committed to anything, to the body of Christ, because we believe the God of the church is the God that we're committed to. And so we're committed to his bride as well. So again, those four things that are current realities for us, we believe the Bible's true. Jesus is the only way to heaven. You have to be born again. And that as Christians, we can live a life devoted to Jesus, to spirit-led living. And that's where I want to challenge us in this message. How are you doing with those things? Where's the Bible in your life? Like, where's your view of scripture? Have you really gone all in with Jesus as Lord of every part of your life? And are you living spirit-led? Are you living out a devoted life? And let me just be clear. We'll never get this 100% right until we meet the Lord face to face. But what does 2021 look like as God is calling you to lay down some things and to devote areas of your life to him? And that's why I wanted to bring this message to you, to really start thinking about that as we approach the new year. There's a book by a friend of mine that's called, the book is called A Call to Resurgence. The author is my friend, Pastor Mark Driscoll, who pastors in the Phoenix area, Scottsdale, Arizona. And he talks about as the church in America, we have some current trends and realities that we really need to deal with face to face. In particular, there are four different types of faith within the church in America. The first is what he calls active faith. It's people who have ownership of their faith. They've taken a priority of cultivating their faith, growing in their devotion life. Church is not just a thing they do, it's a part of their lives. They belong to the body of Christ, right? And so he would say for active faith, while some polls say 40 to 70% of Americans are Christian, the reality is John Dickerson's research shows that closer to 5 to 10% of Americans actually have an active faith in Christ, where they're pursuing the Lord in prayer, devotion, worship, trying to live for him. So there's active faith. Then there's what he calls borrowed faith. And this is the common reality for a lot of church attenders in the American church. They've borrowed the faith of their grandmother, their parents. Maybe they go to a denominational church because that's the kind of church they were raised in. But church is kind of a stop. It's a hotel visit, not a home for them. And so their faith is borrowed on the faith of their preacher or the kind of tribe that they're a part of or grew up in. And he says borrowed faith is about 2/3 of self-identified church attenders or Christians. Borrowed faith is the reality for most church folks. Now, I'm not saying this is true for you at Life Point Church. I don't know these current trends or realities. I'm just telling you some of the research that I found from this book. And he says that 2/3 of self-identified Christians haven't been to church in the last year except for holidays. And I think if anything, COVID has exposed that even more. In fact, Barna Research just put out a survey that showed that like 34% of folks who were regular church attenders have not been to church, tuned into church, logged into their church's website or social media, or been to a small group at all since the pandemic really elevated in March of 2020. The third area he calls is lost faith. And that's the inevitable result of borrowed faith, that over time and down the generational line, borrowed faith becomes lost faith. In other words, it's no longer enough that it's just my grandma's religion or my dad's faith. But if I don't have ownership of that myself, what I'm borrowing from others ultimately becomes something of no value to me and ultimately becomes lost faith, which leads to the inevitable fourth faith reality, which is no faith. And there's been quite a bit written lately about what they're calling the rise or the resurging or the surging of people who check none or no faith on surveys, et cetera. In fact, the overwhelming trend in millennials and Gen X or Z or whatever the youngest generation is 95% have no active faith in Christ, and a large percent, it's growing all the time, are claiming no faith at all. Agnostic, atheist, definitely not Christian. So here's the thing. We can't continue with business as usual and still be about God's kingdom and promoting God's kingdom as a church. We have to realize that the no faith people matter, that those with lost and borrowed faith need discipleship, maturity. They need the body of Christ to come around them. And we should all want to be moving forward towards what he calls active faith. That's what revolutionary living is going to be about this year. So I'm challenging you in 2021 to consider some revolutionary steps towards active faith. I'm giving you some current realities because I'm a numbers guy. I kind of nerd out on some of those statistics and numbers, and I think they're valuable, but I'm also a numbers guy towards you. And if those stats are true about the church in America, then some of those stats are probably true about the church at Life Point. And that means you matter to me so deeply that these stats matter to us. So then let me challenge you then with a time for revolution. A time for revolution. If you look in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, starting in verse 23, Jesus says, if anyone would come after me, if anybody wants to follow me, if anybody's going to be my disciple, if anybody's going to be in my family, let him first, look at this, deny himself, which is always our biggest hangup. Like my biggest hangup in getting closer to Jesus is me. It's not what's happening around me, outside of me, or what others are thinking, doing, or believing. It's always going to be me. My predilections, my predispositions, my beliefs, the things that I'm dogmatic about and I don't want to change. Jesus said, if anybody's going to follow me, let him first deny himself, then take up his cross. And we don't really get the use of that language in modern culture because we don't crucify people by cross. Think of it like this. Take up his own death sentence. Take up his own demise. Take up the loss of everything valuable and precious. Take up their cross daily. It's an everyday event. It's not just a one-time thing you did back in middle school. It's every day. Take up his cross and then follow me. This is where Jesus calls us all to follow Christ. We've got to deny ourselves, take up our pleasures and our whole worldview, take up our cross, and follow Jesus. He says, whoever would save his life will actually lose it. So if you're trying to preserve and get all you can and be all you want, you're actually going to lose eternal life. He said, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. And then he goes on to say, what does it profit a person if he gains the whole world? Like you may get all wealth, riches, and notoriety and fame and all that kind of stuff. But if you lose your soul, what does it profit a man to get everything in the world has to offer and lose your salvation? Jesus had an all or nothing view of salvation, of following him. There was no variance for him. In fact, numerous times his disciples would say to him how hard it is to follow him and his teachings. And that life was with Jesus was full devotion. You know, as a church at Life Point, we say our mission is to lead people in full devotion to Jesus. So a revolutionary year looks like, what does it look like for you to deny yourself, take up your cross, and live in full devotion to Jesus? So let me challenge you in three areas. And this is what I really want you to pray about between now and the beginning of next year and really dedicate yourself to in your time of fasting. But between now and the end of the year, you and your family, your loved ones, write some notes about this and put some things to paper of where you want to have a revolutionary year in 2021. The first area is in revolutionary spiritual formation. Now, spiritual formation is an academic term that we use. Basically, it's a term that we use to describe your life with Christ, your spiritual life, your devotion life. So what does it look like for you to have revolutionary spiritual formation? Like revolutionary prayer life. Do you spend time with God beyond praying for meals and bedtimes? If all you pray is meals and bedtimes, that's not a prayer life. So what does it look like for you to establish maybe 30 minutes a day, 20 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes at night of just being with God, worshiping God, spending time in prayer? Write it down. What does it look like for you to have a goal of a revolutionary prayer life in 2021? Second, what does it look like for you to have revolutionary devotion to the Word of God? Many people, I've heard over the years, people have said, you know, I've read the Bible, but that never impresses me. I want to know if you're reading the Bible. Are you studying the Bible? Are you marinating on the Bible? Are you letting it saturate your life? If you don't have a Bible reading plan, we actually have one available for you online on our website at lifepointchurch.tv. Our small groups team can get that for you. It's also going to be printed in our Pray First guide that's available at the beginning of the year. But get on a plan. Set time. Make it an appointment on your calendar every day to spend time in God's Word. If you've not read the Bible in the last 3 weeks, to read the Bible for 3 days in a row would be a revolution, a violent change from the norm. What does it look like for you to have revolutionary Bible time and prayer time? What does it look like for you to have revolutionary worship and fasting and some other spiritual disciplines? I just want to encourage you to set some goals, set some revolutions in your life as we go into 2021. The second area of revolution I want to challenge you in is in this area of stewardship. Now, many of us, when we hear stewardship, we think, oh, great, here's a fundraiser. I'm not interested in fundraising. I've never been a good fundraiser. That's not my heart. My heart for you in stewardship is, what does it look like for God to own every part of your life? What does it look like for God to own your time and God to own the resources that He's given you anyway? What does it look like for your first thought to be, Lord, what do you want to do with this versus what do I get to do with this? And some of the easiest ways it comes out is in our calendars, in our finances and budgeting, and in how we serve other people. But I want to challenge you in this area of revolutionary stewardship. Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. In 1 Timothy, Paul writes, he says, we brought nothing into this world and we can take nothing with us. Here's some practical steps for you. If you've never been a giver to the Lord through your local church, I want to encourage you, that would be a revolutionary decision this year to become a giver. If you are a giver, but you've never been a tither, that's really where I think the floor is for Christian giving. I want to challenge you to become a tither in 2021. 10% before taxes, what you give to the Lord and you give it through your local church. Trust me when I say, we're not going to police your life over this. We're not going to come at you about, this is about you saying, Lord, everything I have is yours. And this first 10th portion is an honor to you to remind myself that it's all yours. And then if you're a tither, maybe God would say, hey, I'm ready for you to be an offering giver, be a legacy giver, a kingdom builder, and give beyond the tithe. But let's revolt against our old giving patterns and let's have a revolutionary year and set some goals, set some practices this year. Finally, I want to challenge you in the area of servanthood. Maybe you've never served others other than the people you like or the people you know or the people in your home. What would it look like for 2021 to be the year that you became a servant of those that are the least of these, those who are having need in your neighborhood, in your church, at your job, that you just set it in your heart that in 2021, I'm going to become a servant of others. Jesus said, I didn't come into this world to be served. He didn't come to be this king where they waved fans and fed him grapes. He said, I came to serve everyone. And he did that by giving his life away as a ransom for everybody. You don't have to do that. You don't have to go to a cross, but you get to give your time away, give your talents away. If you're a singer, sing for somebody. If you're a door opener, open somebody's door in their lives. If you're a connector, connect people. What does it look like for this to be a year of revolutionary spiritual formation, revolutionary stewardship, and revolutionary serving? As we go into 2021, let me challenge you to set some goals, set some parameters in your life, to revolt against maybe the patterns of your past, that I'm gonna set some trajectory in my life. I'm gonna set some decisions of giving, of serving, of spiritual formation, of spending time with God. And here's what I wanna do. I wanna pray over that for you. And as a church, we're gonna collectively go forward together in our walk with God. I want us as a church to have the biggest year of prayer, the greatest year of worship and singing loud to God. I want us to have the greatest year in the scripture that we've ever had. Here's what I believe. Our world desperately is waiting. The Bible says in Romans, this world is desperately waiting on the people of God to be revealed. They're crying out, waiting on us to be revealed to this world. And what we have to reveal is a deep love and devotion for the God of heaven, who's bigger than this world has to offer. He has more to say and more to give and more to offer than our culture, than the stories and the lies of this world. But I'm telling you, that revelation of us to this world has to be an overflow of us revolting against our flesh, revolting against our own patterns, and leaning into spiritual formation, generosity, stewardship, the things God is calling us to. Hey, I want to pray for you. And I want to pray that God would encourage you in this message, encourage your family, challenge you guys to take some steps forward into this new year. I hope it's been a blessing for you in Jesus' name. Come on, let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing in your church. Thank you, Lord God, that you've allowed us to be a church in Clarksville and even around the world through our digital platforms. Thank you, Lord God, that you've allowed LifePoint to speak into the hearts of people as we approach 2021. God, as we prepare for 21 days of fasting, I pray, Lord God, that every one of us would commit to a revolutionary year in the area of stewardship, spiritual formation, serving others. And I thank you, Lord God, that you will meet us in January. You're meeting with us now. You're with our families. You're with our homes. But God, I pray that you would meet us in 2021 and that we would have the most amazing year we've ever had as servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, God, we're all in. Come on, pray this with me as we do every week. Say, God, I'm all in. I believe in Jesus, that he died for my sin so that I can live my life completely for him. I give you every part of me. I'm ready for a revolutionary year. To God be the glory, in Jesus' name, amen. Hey, what a pleasure to be with you today. I hope you have a wonderful New Year's Eve, safe holiday, and a great new year. Cannot wait to see you again for 21 days of fasting and prayer. And our new series, Jesus in the 20s, starts the first Sunday of January. I love you, LifePoint. God bless you. Grace and peace out.